Hey, as I was out last night in East Lansing, as a matter of fact, somebody asked me if I was going to come to Ann Arbor and see the Messiah. I'm wondering how comfortable or uncomfortable you are with this perception that you're the savior of Michigan football.
I'm not comfortable with that at all, as I said.
Afternoon. Today I informed Brady Hoke that he will not be returning as our football coach next year. And I had mentioned to all of you a couple weeks ago that we would be evaluating his status at the end of the season, and that's what today's announcement is about. So my primary intent today is to do this with deep respect for Brady, his family, the coaches, and all of those associated with our football program, and it's because of their contributions to the University of Michigan. This was not an easy decision. You see, I believe the longevity of our best football coaches are tied to the intersection of the performance or measure of wins and losses with the test and expression of values that underscore their program. And everywhere I go, there is zero question about Brady's values. And I mentioned this trait 2 weeks ago to you. Brady's peers, both active and retired coaches, really respect him. And his players love playing for him. He's done a great job of molding these young men and focusing them on success in the classroom and in the community. He's really earned the respect of all as being a value-centered coach. We need more men like him in sport today. So you might ask, how do you reconcile the tension between results and values? Now, one could also make the argument that we have a very young team, and we're about to pivot next year into being an extraordinary team. It has to do with making sure, then, that Brady has received adequate time to exhibit that arc of improvement that would come from his effort. And I believe that Brady had enough time to produce results, and they're just not there today. Therefore, I believe it's time to make this transition. Now, I don't plan on sharing more of Brady's performance review or assessment, frankly, because I believe the dignity of this conversation is for him only. My next focus is to make sure that this exit for Brady is handled in a first-class way, with heightened consideration for not only Brady himself, but his staff and his family. Brady's a hero. He's been an employee in our university for over 12 years. So what's next? Well, I plan on starting the search for his replacement immediately. We want to build on what's been established by Brady. My message to the student athletes is that we'll work to put them in the best position to win and reinforce that their daily effort is contributing toward being champions. The criteria for our future coach is defined in winning with the shared values of the University of Michigan. So I ask for your patience in this search process. It's not fair for me to comment on potential candidates today or the institutions or organizations they currently may be employed by. I can't compromise the integrity of our search process by commenting prematurely until we have that new coach ready to go. I believe that the head coach of Michigan football is one of the finest jobs in American sports today, and we will have great options. The University of Michigan remains one of the top programs in the country. Now, it's true that the pendulum has swung into a negative. However, one truth in physics is that as a pendulum is in the negative state, it's always building energy for its eventual move back to a positive arc. And my objective is to find the right coach for the University of Michigan, an individual that will recruit the best student athletes and put them in a position to win in the classroom, on the field, and in the community. This is what makes Michigan world class, and we're going to support that with great enthusiasm.
The light rain, biting cold, half-empty tailgate lots, and of course lost to Maryland in Michigan's home 2014 finale, provided the fitting going-away party scene for Coach Brady Hoke. The Wolverines dismissed Hoke after another season without a Big Ten championship. It's time for a new direction in Ann Arbor. Firing Hoke was appropriate for a program that has over the past 7 years strayed dramatically from its traditional success, first under Rich Rodriguez and then under Hoke. During that stretch, Michigan lost six or more games five times. U of M dropped six just once in the previous 40 seasons.
Touchdown, Michigan!
Hoke was supposed to represent a rekindling of the Michigan tradition, and he brought a sensibility about the program that Rodriguez did not. He called the school in Columbus, Ohio, and his previous stint as a Wolverine assistant appeared to give him the necessary maize and blue bona fides. But Hoke learned quickly that embracing Michigan tradition wasn't enough. He and his staff did not make the players better, and his inability to provide forceful leadership led to a softening of a program that had been built on Bo Schembechler's bile and grit. Hoke's unwillingness to wear a headset on the sidelines made him appear out of touch with what was happening, and his handling, along with deposed athletic director David Brandon, of backup quarterback Shane Morris's concussion, was amateurish. The Wolverine must make a change, but the school can't afford another misfire. It must find someone who understands Michigan, but also has the experience of running a Power 5 program, something Hoke lacked. It may not be easy. Interim AD Jim Hackett might have problems attracting a top name, since no coach wants to be hired by someone who isn't guaranteed to stick around. But whoever takes over, whether it's Les Miles, Dan Mullen, or someone else, must revive a program that has lost significant traction on the Big Ten and national scenes. Hoke had his chance, but for all of his Michigan rhetoric and embracing of the school's past, he couldn't bring the Wolverines into a brighter future. U of M must now find someone that understands its culture and can win championships for a change.
No, that can't be a factor.
Jim, do you think Jed York and Trent Baalke want you to be continued to be the coaches?
Yeah, my priorities are number one, winning football games. Number two, the welfare of our players, coaches, our staff. And lastly is what my personal professional future is.
Have you been able to maintain focus throughout this?
Yes.
Do you think you've coached well last month?
Well, yeah, to take responsibility. So that's it falls on me. We don't win these games. That's my number one priority, winning football games.
Ask this question every Monday. If it's up to you, do you want to be back with the 49ers next year?
Tell you what my priorities are. My priorities are winning games.
All right.
Thank you.
Charles Woodson of the Oakland Raiders joining me here now on the Rich Eisen Show. Let's get down to brass tacks about our school, our program. Charles, the floor is yours. What do you think is going on with our football program in Ann Arbor?
Oh man, I don't know. It's hard to put a finger on it. You know, it just seems you know, the last couple of years, you know, we just, for whatever reason, you know, just haven't been able to get it done. It seems, you know, that once Lori Carr was gone, you know, things were just kind of in disarray, and we just haven't had the, you know, I guess the steadiness that we had, you know, when Coach Carr was around. And things have been up and down. So, you know, hopefully, however this process is going, man, that we can find the right person to come in there and right the ship.
Well, the right person in many people's mind, including Coach Carr, for whom you played, said it was the guy who was across the field from you just 3 days ago, yeah. Charles. Did you say anything to Harbaugh at all?
You know, I spoke to him briefly, you know, and, you know, just said what's up. And, you know, I almost started to get into the conversation, but, you know, he kind of gave me the same line that he gave everybody in the press conference. You know, he worried about the winning, the well-being of his team, and the well-being of his family. So that was about as far as we got into it as we were going to get.
So if, because again, you've got an interim head coach, and everybody says that he could be the next coach of the Oakland Raiders potentially. If there's a choice for you, Charles Woodson, I'm going to give it to you. You could sidestep it if you want. That's totally understandable. I still got to ask you. If you wanted him as the next head coach, if you stay in Oakland as the Raiders or have him in Michigan, what would your choice be?
Well, I think if the choice was out there, it would definitely be Michigan for me. You know, I would, you know, a guy that played there, you know, I think the fans would love it. I think it'd be great for, you know, recruiting and all of that. And then, you know, just to have a guy that's proven. I mean, he's won everywhere he's been, you know, as a coach. And I don't think it would be any different, you know, if he went to Michigan. So I would say, yeah.
Yeah. So you go blue is right, Charles. Because if you think about it, on the show yesterday, I looked at the camera and I told Jimmy to come home. I told him to come home.
Yeah.
That we need him.
Did you plead with him?
I did.
Yeah.
Do you think I'm wasting my breath, though? You saw it in his eyes. Am I wasting my breath? Do you think there's a little bit of, like, even a dumb and dumber chance that we're saying there's a chance? Is there a chance here, you think?
Yeah. The way it sounds to me, that's not even that one in a million that you got on Dumb and Dumber. So it doesn't sound too good right now.
What happens now in Ann Arbor? Because so many people, when they hear folks like you and me, we had Charles Woodson on yesterday, talk reverentially about these times, that because of the 21st century and what college football is now, that there's no way to recapture it in Ann Arbor. And that's such a feeling of desolation, certainly right. Over the last two coaching staffs not winning,
yeah.
And not, or at least not performing in a manner that we've come to expect it, and we're called arrogant for it. Where do you stand on this subject, Desmond?
Well, Rich, we're in a really, really tough position. If you look at the big picture, because the three most powerful people at the University of Michigan are the president, the AD, and the head football coach. And all of those positions have been compromised in one way or another. We have a brand-new president who just came from, I believe, Brown University. And obviously, I'm sure you're aware that, you know, he spoke about a month ago, and then he was doing good when he talked about academics, because that's in his wheelbarrow. Mm-hmm. But then he tried to venture off to athletics, and he kind of put his foot in his mouth, had to come back out and apologize and recant statements. So we have this brand-new president, Mark Schlissel, who doesn't, you know, have a great understanding of the importance of intercollegiate sports, especially football, especially at a school like the University of Michigan. Then we have an interim AD, Jim Hackett. I think he's a brilliant man, but he has that interim tag right now in front of his name, and that can turn some big-time head coaches off, especially when you're out there searching for a big-time head coach. Like you said, the last two head coaches haven't performed up to our expectations, so therefore now we're looking for a new coach. So you have you're in a position where you got to hire a new head coach, you know, one of the three most powerful people at the university. The athletic director has an interim tag in front of his name. You know, I think he's going to do a thorough job in researching and gathering data, but you have to be concerned when he has the term interim in front of the athletic department. I mean, athletic director, because some big name head coaches may get turned off by that. And then, like I said, you have a brand new president. So the situation is very interesting and very unique. And I think that this hire is probably, you know, the biggest, most important, most significant hire that we've seen in quite some time up in Ann Arbor.
Well, let's talk. Call it brass tacks.
Jed and Trent, maybe in the near future, do you want to sit down with them and talk about your future?
Yeah, I'm always available to sit down with the owner or the general manager. Absolutely.
Do you expect to have a conversation about coming back next year?
Yeah, at some point. Expect that.
The University of Michigan has offered a six-year, $48 million contract to Jim Harbaugh to come home. And we all know, I've said it on this program many times, and I've been unabashed in banging this drum, even though many of my colleagues in the information world, in our sports media world, have been telling me not to bang the drums. I've heard from so many people saying Jimmy's not coming home. But until I hear it from Jim Harbaugh's mouth, I'm going to keep banging this drum. Jimmy, come home. Come home. The University of Michigan throwing its arms and its bank account open. Jimmy, come home. Now, it's all speculation right now. So I'm going to do what many, many folks do in real life without their own show from the field of Everbank Field. And it's to call up a friend and speculate. I need a speculating buddy. And who better than at Poison Pill 76 himself, a seven-time Pro Bowler. National champion from the University of Michigan, Steve Hutchinson. Hutch, help me out here. Let's
Richie
speculate
Rich,
together.
You sleeping at night?
What do you think?
Oh, man, I don't know. It's rough sleeping at night. I know we've been texting back and forth the last couple of days, but, you know, it's at this point it is purely speculation. I got to give the university credit, though. I mean, I feel as though 8 years ago, or was it 9 years ago now, before the Rich Rod hire, this is the approach they should have taken. The tight-lipped, don't show your hand, don't tip your hand at all, because, you know, you're leaving the door open for a lot of speculation, but you're not floating names out there. You know, I mean, you've never heard anything about Harbaugh from the university's mouth. It's just what everybody's writing. So it's not like they've put out a list of three or four candidates and they're gonna, you know, the first you guys fight over it, first one to take it, it's theirs. You know, it's I got to give them credit the way they're doing it.
Well, Hutch, you know, that's the thing that I'm now wondering is the leak and why it came out and who's the one who's doing it. And everybody's right. Saying, well, it's leverage for Harbaugh. And the only leverage that I would see it for being, and again, this is absolute total speculation, and I am saying that right up front. The only reason why it would be out there is to fire a shot across the 49ers' bow to say, this is out there. And I can take this thing and leave you, right, scot-free, which I'm assuming he can do,
right,
and that they can't get whatever draft compensation they might be able to get if they trade him within the NFL.
Well,
that
might, was, you know,
or
we
it's just any,
go ahead. Sorry.
Go for it.
No, I discussed or this last week just, on the Big Ten Network. I mean, you know, everybody was asking me, well, what are they going to do? What are they doing? And I don't know. I mean, the university's not calling me. You know, Jim Hackett's not calling me for my input. But to me, when you're in the midst, if you're going to hire a college coach or your sights were set on one of these big-time, up-and-coming, younger college coaches, now's the prime time. I mean, you're missing because pretty soon you're starting your recruiting season and you want to have a coach that's been there a couple weeks, get the word out. But, you know, in my opinion, if you're not saying one thing and you don't have any guys coming in for interviews to Ann Arbor and you're not doing anything like that at all, to me, you're going after a guy that's not in the college ranks. So I've said all along, whether it's Jim or another coach we don't know about, I think they're going after somebody. And right now I think it is Jim. And if, like I said at the beginning when I came on, if they're going to – they're doing it the right way. I mean, you throw the money at the guy that you think he's going to want a demand from either another job in the league, and you hope that his loyalty to the university and his love for the university is enough to push him over the edge, right?
Yeah, well, I mean, I hear, there's no way Michigan actually offered this type of money because it's so out of character for the school, certainly based on what's been going on in Ann Arbor for the past few years. And also I hear that absolutely this is the guy that they need, and it makes sense on every level. And I've been sort of tongue-in-cheek telling Jimmy to come home. I think it does work for him on that level as well, but I'm not talking about his personal life. I'm just talking about his professional life, about going ahead and coming back to a university where he would be loved on the spot. He already is, and the university needs him. They need a guy like him to fire up the alumni and the fan base, and he, at this point of his career, sort of needs that, because you have to wonder in the NFL, which is another thing I'm thinking about leaking this information, it would be basically setting the price for any NFL team that wants to go get him, that I don't see where he can go, right, and have the ability to stay forever, where right. Every single year new recruits come in and his way of coaching is fresh once every 4 years. You know what I'm saying?
Right. Correct. You know, to your first point about Michigan being out of character, offering that kind of contract, it kind of pains me to say this, and I'm sure it would you as well, but, you know, I don't think Michigan, they lost that right to kind of name their price, you know. I think we fell from the graces a little bit the last couple of years, and our record definitely shows that. So if you want to get back to that status of – if you want to compete with the Nick Sabans of the world and the Alabamas and be thrown in the mix for a national championship year after year, you get what you pay for.
There's a question about whether a team like the Chicago Bears would make a move for Jim Harbaugh, but there'll be no shortage of teams that go after Jim Harbaugh, and any team that is making a head coaching change this offseason in the coming weeks will certainly look at Jim Harbaugh if he's available, and the thinking continues to be that he will stay in the NFL because that's what he wants to do.
Okay, Adam, thanks. Herm and then Mark, pick the best landing spot for Jim.
I would say the Oakland Raiders. His wife loves living on the West Coast. It's a team that has a young quarterback. And I would hope if you're the 49ers, we hear a lot what's going on right now. Do the right thing by your coach. That would help the 49ers' image as well. I mean, there's been a lot of, we hear the animosity, but do the right thing for your coach. Your organization is going to survive it. You're going to get another head coach in there if you decide to trade him. They probably would like to trade him rather than this. To flat fire him because they'd get something for him.
Well, but on the trade note, if they send him to a team he doesn't want to go to, he can say, I'm not going, and sit out, couldn't
well,
he?
Yeah. I mean, and that's why you don't want to make this thing complicated. You want to make it as smooth as you can.
So they need to find common ground.
Yes.
Right. Yeah, and I think it's simple. And I agree with Coach. I think the Oakland Raiders make the most sense, but I'm almost certain that he will coach in the National Football League. That's the one
not
thing.
Not Michigan.
Yeah, I just don't see him going back to college. I think he has something to prove. He almost won a Super Bowl as a player. Yep. He hasn't won a Super Bowl as a coach. I think that's really important to him.
49ers head coach Jim Harbaugh is days away from making one of the biggest decisions of his career. He's going to have to decide whether he wants to remain in the NFL, where there are expected to be head coaching opportunities for him, or whether he wants to go back to school, back to the University of Michigan, where he once learned at the feet of Michigan coaching legend Bo Schembechler and played quarterback for the Michigan Wolverines. Harbaugh's family and friends are said to be encouraging him to go back to school. His father, Jack, once coached at Michigan with the Michigan interim athletic director, Jim Hackett, and they would love to see Jim Harbaugh go back to Michigan. But ultimately, the decision belongs to Jim Harbaugh. And in the NFL, there is unfinished business. He has not won a Super Bowl. He would love to continue to chase a Super Bowl, but his school is also calling.
We were kind of talking before the show had started about how it seems like NFL insiders and whatnot, only one guy, maybe Adam Schefter, has really a pulse on what's going on there. But what's the deal with those guys coming out and saying something and then guys like you who have maybe more background information?
Well, because Jim Harbaugh doesn't talk to anybody in the NFL. I mean, I think that's pretty clear. I mean, you've seen his press conferences. They're about as cryptic as can be, you know. He doesn't say much. There's nobody that's plugged into the NFL that's plugged into Jim Harbaugh or Jim Harbaugh's camp. That's why you're always going to hear NFL guys, because they're, you know, like, they're protecting the shield.
They're getting stuff from his agents.
Right. Agents and agents talk and what have you.
Yeah, so. but Jim's is kind of, in the end, Jim's his own guy. He's his own agent.
You had to handicap it percentage-wise. How sure are you?
100%.
Wow, there it is. Okay.
Wow, well, it's Christmas.
I do want to talk a little bit about college.
Hello, Lowell.
How you doing?
Doing good. Doing good. So it's a great win.
Craig Dahl gave you the ball that he intercepted and you carried that off the field. What did that gesture mean to you?
Meant a lot. Much appreciated. Just the way I feel about these players, these coaches, this staff, this organization. It's like that. Been the time of my life. Been a lot of great memories, great moments.
Jim, do you expect to be the next coach at Michigan?
There'll be announcements made, you know, concerning those things. But I want to really focus and concentrate on how much appreciate you too. Appreciate the fans, media, the people that I mentioned in terms of our football team. Great allies, great friends, and people are going to be friends with forever. That's the way I feel about it. It's things that were accomplished here. We're very, very good.
You had a discussion with Jed before the game. Was that just to say goodbye? What was that conversation generally about?
Yeah, that was a pre-game talk. Yeah, personal.
He has said
Jim, that. Is there sadness after 4 years of being here and doing the things you did on this day? I mean, does it feel? Is it a sad moment for you?
I don't know how to say it. I mean, maybe don't have the words for it, but anyway, say it this way. As I've said all along, I mean, you work at the pleasure of the organization, and it's come to. It has been a tremendous 4 years. And it's been a pleasure to work and serve for this. For this organization, for these players, for this football team, and I feel great about what we accomplished. I feel great about the friendships that were made, the relationships that were made. I mean, that's what a team is—a set of relationships. I feel good.
You've said recently your number one priority as a head coach is to win football games. You did a lot of that in 4 years. Do you leave here feeling like, you know, short of the Lombardi Trophy, that you accomplished everything you could have?
I felt we accomplished great things. Tremendous football. And so many people to thank for that. So many people worked so hard to, you know, construct, you know, where this football team is. And feel great to be a part of it. Feel it's been a signature years in my life. And I have much gratitude for everyone involved.
Coach Harbaugh, so from what you're saying, did you coach your last game as the head coach of the San Francisco 49ers today?
You know, there's going to be statements made. I know that the organization has a statement that they want to release, so I will defer to that.
Can you share at all what you told the team about what will happen?
Yeah, just how much I appreciate them. Just how much I love them, and
did you tell them about anything that will happen, or did you address that part of it?
Yeah, we addressed, and
Jim, will you be here tomorrow for your weekly news conference?
We'll see. Let me think about that.
I'm just thinking of being here. Nice,
let's get together. Okay. Let's do that. That would be fantastic.
Jim, do you leave on good terms with Jed York and Trent Baalke?
Yes. Yes. As I said, everybody, this has been as I described it. I mean, this has been had a time of my life. You know, there's that song. That's had the time of my life. I did. I really did. Had a lot of fun. And it's the relationships that were made along the way, and that's what a team is. And I appreciate the fans, the people of the Bay Area, the 49er faithful, all the good times that we've had, together. That's a relationship that we've had. I think it's been really good and fantastic. And players, coaches, staff, friends for life.
Is this your choice to move on, or is this their choice?
As I said, I mean, you work at the pleasure of the organization. That's what we all do.
Jim, is this your ideal way for Frank Gore to finish out this?
Thank you. Yes, let's talk about Frank Gore. Wow. I don't know, again, I'm not going to have the words for it, but I mean, what an unwavering competitor, and this is Frank Gore will have another year of football next year. There's no question about that. Tremendous season, tremendous character and football player. I mean, there is a football heaven that's awaiting Frank Gore and so many of our players. Justin Smith, Colin Kaepernick, Bruce Miller, there's so many of them. Michael Crabtree, Anquan Boldin, Antoine Bethea, Chris Culliver. What a great game for Chris Culliver today, too. So many of them. I mean, whether relationship was 4 years or you know, just a couple weeks, I was incredibly close to this team, and I'll forever appreciate that.
Jim, was this a tough
season? And I'm forever proud. Forever proud to have been a part of this, been a part of this football team.
Jim, was this a tough season for you overall, though, just given everything you had to deal with?
Yeah, we battled. We battled. The team battled from beginning to the end. That's what you do. And you start something, you finish it. I felt like, you know, like all of our guys, I feel like this way. I mean, you do your best, and that's what you do. Some people may look at it as not good enough, but you do your best. If your best isn't appreciated, then you do your best anyway. And I think that's what our football team did this year.
You were appreciated this year?
Yes. Yeah. I have so much gratitude because of so many things that's given, the respect that the players have always shown, the way they've always, you know, given it their very best. I mean, that's all you can ask. If you know, I've said it many times, it's a joy to coach this.
Where was your last Gatorade shower before this? Remember? Atlanta? Remember? Green Bay?
2011 maybe? Or? Yeah.
Jim, you think you're going to miss the NFL? You talk about the great players. You know, are you going to miss the NFL in any way?
The NFL going somewhere?
You might be.
All right, thank you for being here today, everybody. First, I want to thank Jim Harbaugh for 4 great seasons with the 49ers. He helped us restore a winning culture, a fiery, competitive culture. I am greatly appreciative of that. I wish him the best. I wish Sarah and his children the best wherever they end up going forward. He will always be a part of this franchise, and I will remember his time here very, very fondly. I want to thank our great fans, the 49er faithful. We didn't give you enough to cheer for this year, but that didn't stop you from coming out. Even in the last 2 games where we really didn't have anything to play for, we weren't playing for a playoff contention, and you guys brought it. And I appreciate that. I appreciate everything that you guys do for us, and it's up to us to make sure we compete for and win Super Bowls. That's our only goal. We don't raise division championship banners. We don't raise NFC championship banners. We raise Super Bowl banners. And whenever we don't deliver that, I hope that you will hold me directly responsible and accountable for it. And we look forward to getting this thing back on track and getting you guys exactly what you deserve.
Yeah, I think what I'd like to, you know, reiterate is exactly what Jed said in so many ways. First of all, a huge thank you to Jim and his leadership. We accomplished a lot of good things, a lot of good things. You know, the ultimate prize in this business is Super Bowls. We all know that. We all understand it. It's what we sign up for going into it. And we didn't reach that goal of a victory, but we got very close on numerous times. And Jim was a huge part of that. He's moved on, and there's no doubt he's a heck of a football coach, and he's going to enjoy success at his next stop, wherever that may be. I know there's speculation of where that may be, but I certainly wish him nothing but the best moving forward, him and his family. And once again, I have no doubt that he'll accomplish great things moving forward.
Idea of the numbers, it seemed like it was, we were hearing numbers at 6 years, $48 million. Is that what you've been hearing ballpark-wise?
Well, again, I have not heard any numbers yet. It's going to be big. It's going to be the highest paid coach in college football history because Michigan was anxious to get him in the fold, wants him in the fold. And again, I think his NFL options were not anywhere near what Michigan was at this
time. Back to that, you said NFL options. Did he want to stay in the NFL if he had an option?
Again, you'd have to ask him, and he'll never say that he did because he's going to be a Michigan man,
yeah.
And he's a Michigan man at heart. But the fact of the matter is, I think, my sense, if everything was on an even playing field and he had similar offers from NFL teams and Michigan, I think he would have stayed in the NFL. But he's going to be at Michigan. His heart is going to be in Michigan. He's going to be all in at Michigan, and it's going to be Jim Harbaugh and Urban Meyer in the Big Ten there going head-to-head the way that Bo Schembechler and Woody Hayes once did back in the day. And Ann Arbor, Michigan, all the people who went there are going to be ecstatic at the news that everybody here has expected the last few days because this has been reported on and reported on. But you never know until these things are, as we talked about, officially signed off on. But the biggest boosters around the school have been told that the deal is done and that Jim Harbaugh is going to be the next head coach at Michigan.
Michigan coming off their third losing season the last 7 years, and we're talking about a guy that immediately changes programs. He changed at San Diego everything in that first year. He changed things immediately at Stanford. He changed things immediately with San Francisco. And when you look at his four-year tenure with the 49ers, 44 total wins in the regular season, five more in the playoffs. No one has won five playoff games in their first three seasons as an NFL head coach. Making that transition, will this be an easy one considering his background at Stanford as well as at San Diego?
He has been the turnaround artist, and Michigan is counting on him being the turnaround artist because the football program is at a low point. It has not been at this point in a very long time, and the expectation is that Jim Harbaugh will come in. He will bring his full-fledged assistant coaching staff. He will go get recruits. He will go into homes and recruit the way that he has at Stanford. Obviously, one of the biggest names, one of the most high-profile names in the business. It'll be a boon for Michigan. It'll be great for the recruiting, and it should be great for the Big Ten and college football in general.
Please join me in welcoming Jim to his first press conference as the Jay Ira and Nikki Harris family head coach of the University of Michigan, Jim Harbaugh.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Gotta apologize for my voice. They dumped Gatorade over me on Sunday after our ball game, and I've lost my vocal cords a little bit. But I don't know if anybody saw me trip on the way in. Did anybody see that? A lesser athlete would have gone down. Top to bottom, Michigan is about excellence. It's about greatness. And you have my pledge that I will carry forward the tradition of excellence of the University of Michigan.
As I was out last night in East Lansing, as a matter of fact, somebody asked me if I was going to come to Ann Arbor and see the Messiah. I'm wondering how comfortable or uncomfortable you are with this perception that you're the savior of Michigan football.
I'm not comfortable with that at all, as I said. As I said, this is I'm standing on a foundation that has been built for over 100 years by some great men. And I feel like I'm standing on their shoulders. And I want to do a good job. I want to be good. We want to win. We want to win at practice. We want to win on the practice field. We want to win in the classroom. We want to win in the community. We want to win on fall Saturday afternoons. And we'll have great expectations for that. Michigan's always been great. There is it's always been great, and I always believe in it.
What's the best thing you could possibly, in terms of selling something, you're selling something that you believe in your core. I made a guarantee a long time ago, and I've learned from that. I've grown. I understand that you don't make guarantees.
It's been exciting to have one of our own come back and coach. It's been exciting to see the whole process and watch, you know, everybody in the NFL scramble, watch everybody in college scramble. And, you know, I loved coming back to Ann Arbor. I knew that he would. And to hear him talk and see the smile on his face, you know, just to hear his answers to all these questions are the same ways that I would feel if I was in his shoes. So I'm glad he's home, and we're glad to have him back.
And I'm very nervous.
I don't think anybody can predict what's going to happen, but I do know that Jim is going to have the support of the great, great majority of the Michigan family.
And he just stands up and talks to you. He doesn't try to BS you, and tomorrow you'll probably get the same kind of motivation in his words as he does today.
Emotionally, there were many layers to the first day of spring ball. A rebirth, a celebration, a homecoming. Better yet, let's let Coach Harbaugh describe it.
A lot of people think January 1st is the start of the new year, and those that believe in Christianity, espouse the Catholicism, believe that correlates with the birth of Christ. But we in football treat the first day of spring practice as the new year. It's like your birthday. It's like the New Year's. It's Thanksgiving. You're thankful that you can participate in football.
Let's do it. There you go.
It's like Christmas. You have this gift. It's like a family reunion. It's all those things all rolled into one. It's happening.
Hut! Don't push it.
It's like the first day of school. Lay your clothes out the night before and pack your lunchbox tight and you head off to school.
Harbaugh charged into his first practice like we knew he would, spending much of his time hands-on with the quarterbacks.
It's the fun part about being the head coach. You can coach any position. You know, you can coach them all, you know, at any time. That's a fun thing about the job of head coach. So I like coaching all the positions at some point.
The media peppered the coach with questions, some about a depth chart. Those answers will be forthcoming as the student-athletes battle it out on the field.
We're not really answering questions as much as we are asking questions, you know. What can we do? How can we get better? Where do we need to, where can we improve? You know, where can we get a mile an hour faster? Where can we get a percent better? And we're all in that process right now.
Of particular interest is quarterback. Right now, there are 7 listed on the roster.
And that'll be the one position I'm sure we'll talk about. And they don't have one to name today. But I don't know. At some point, you'd like to think that that's clear cut and somebody earns that. And it's not close. That's what we'll be hoping for.
To get the guys ready for spring, strength and conditioning coach Kevin Tolbert put in countless hours, and Harbaugh says he liked the results.
Team's in very good shape. Kevin Tolbert, his staff, did a very nice job, and the fellas did a nice job. You could see that throughout practice. The team's in good condition, and that gives us a fighting chance.
I asked Coach Harbaugh for a grade on day number one. He simply said, very good. The Wolverines will be in meetings Wednesday and then back here at Glick Fieldhouse for practice number 2 on Thursday. For mgoblue.com, I'm Ed Kingerski.
There are very special words that are in the English language that we all embrace. There's family. There's friends. There's teammates. There's victory. I was reminded of another very special word when I was driving into Ann Arbor this morning, and that word is homecoming.
On the bottom end to 65,000 on the top end. Judge Judy, however, not there, much to Jim Harbaugh's dismay. Shane Morris, Alex Malzone were first play from scrimmage. Malzone hands off to Davion Smith. Sometimes the best thing a young quarterback can do is nothing. Let the running back do the work. 34 yards would not, however, lead to any points. Well, Shane Morris says it worked so well for Malzone. Let me try it to Antonio Whitfield. Joe Bolden thinks that's a really bad idea. 5-yard loss at the hands of Bolden, one of the best defensive players in this game. Later in the first, still scoreless, Malzone picked off by Brandon Watson Howard. How about the DB play here?
Yeah, outstanding play. Don't know if it would have stood during the regular season, but still, the concentration and being in a place to make the right play was outstanding.
You're questioning officiating and we're in the spring?
Absolutely.
That's early terrible. Second quarter, Malzone picked off again by Desmond Morgan. Tough decision, but a great play by Morgan. Later, now in the second quarter, we're playing 4 10-minute quarters. Morris goes down at the hands of Lawrence Marshall. A few plays later, it's 3rd and 28. This is Morris's best throw of the day. Drops it in the bucket. Amara Darbo comes up with a 36-yard reception, and we are working the 2-minute offense. Under 30 seconds to play in the second quarter. It's Morris to Jerron Dukes. It was the Dukes. 14 yards on the touchdown. As Jerry prefaced, only touchdown of the day. It is 7-0 Blue. Pick it up in the third quarter. Morris tipped by Jabril Peppers, picked off by Hill. And Jerry, Peppers is upset with himself. As a matter of fact, he's going to go do some calisthenics.
He's got to catch that one 4 or 5. Perfect push-ups, by the way.
Yeah, that's Jerry DiNardo form. Later in the quarter, Morris taken down again. And again, it's Joe Bolden going to play a huge role on the 2015 defense. Some trickery then. Malzone to J.U. Chesson, down to Maurice Ways, 32 yards. We saw quite a few trick plays dialed up in this one, perhaps a sign of things to come. Seconds left in the fourth. Mays trying to get on the board, but Chesson steps out and Blue wins 7-0. Sue Ann Roback, why don't you handle post-game reaction?
How much fun did you have out here today?
Oh, it was awesome. I mean, you know, being able to finish up spring ball with the game against, we have two teams, and it was just a lot of fun, and really enjoyed being out here playing with my guys.
And you were able to have the only score of the game. Talk about that play, and it really seemed like you had things going in the right direction, especially on that drive.
Yeah, I mean, obviously with the 7-0 game, it shows how great our defenses are, and they just did really well all day, and, you know, it's hard to score. But, you know, it's the last play, we had a bigger receiver, Jerron Dukes. I threw it up for him, and he went up and got it in the touchdown. It was a great play.
We've heard so much about the quarterback competition. Everything is about competition with Coach Harbaugh. How are you approaching that? Because it seems like there are so many quarterbacks on this team.
Yeah. I mean, it's competition. That's what it is. Even if you're the starter, you're still competing for the job every single day. And that's what I'm doing. I'm going out there, working as hard as I possibly can, going 100% in every drill, every rep I take, just trying to be the best that I can be, trying to get better. And learning from Coach Harbaugh is awesome. He's a great coach, and I'm just trying to soak up everything he has.
Over the overall, the spring ball, Shane would be ahead. And that's the competition will rage on, though, starting tomorrow, you know, into April and into May and certainly into June and July and August.
And what a day it's been for Michigan fans here in Ann Arbor and across the globe as Jim Harbaugh is officially back home as the University of Michigan's 20th head football coach.
From the University of Michigan, joining me back on the Rich Eisen Show, Charles Woodson. Charles, how are you?
Rich, man, I'm doing great. Doing great, man.
It's a great day.
Hey, this is a great day, man.
Please join me in welcoming Jim Harbaugh. Yeah.
You have my pledge that I will carry forward the tradition of excellence of the University of Michigan football program.
Ladies and
day with an enthusiasm unknown to mankind.
Every single day. Just think if you could do that as a football player or a student.
1% better a day would mean in a month, you'd be 30% better. By the time the football season started, you would be 90% better than what you are right now. Sometimes you can't always get 1% better, but maybe you get 0.5% better, maybe even 0.01% better each day. Would that be worth it? Would you want to chase that? You gosh darn right you want to chase that. Every single day you want to chase that. So, every single day, that's what we're looking for. So simple. Think about how simple that is. Simple, pretty simple, right? If I can just get better every single day, then I am going to be much better, and it will be worth it, all right? So what that requires, though, is every day, every single day, when your head hits that nice soft pillow at night, that you have done work, that you have sweated, that you have studied, that your muscles are sore, aching a little bit. You hit that pillow and you go right to sleep. You're gonna feel that tonight. Tonight you're gonna feel it. You're not gonna have to wonder if you got better today.
Thank you very much, Michigan fans in the college football world. Has been looking forward to this upcoming moment for quite some time as the former Michigan star quarterback Jim Harbaugh makes his debut as the head coach of the Wolverines.
I don't think there's been a more hyped or anticipated coaching debut than I can remember in our sport. And it's that way because Jim Harbaugh could have gone anywhere in America in any level and been the head coach. It was that way because he's a winner. He's proved himself time and time again. Jim Harbaugh chose to come home to Michigan, and the Michigan Jim Harbaugh era starts tonight in Salt Lake City.
91, Corey Butler-Burns.